How is that? All right. Good morning. As I yell that into the mic. Good to see you all. What a pleasure to be here. The weather is phenomenal. I think it's only going to be in the 70s today, right? The sun is out. And we have chosen to be here and practice together. Yeah. I guess I should introduce myself. I'm Gary Sanders. I am recently moved here from Los Angeles. I was part of the Against the Stream Sangha, the Dharma Punks community worldwide. I had my own Sangha in Santa Clarita, SCV Mindfulness. I've already moved away and that's the old life, and I am so grateful to be here in Portland, and to be part of this sangha. I really feel like this is my dharma home here. I've checked out some other places. There are great communities within Portland, and I felt when I walked in the doors, I felt at home here. I felt safe. I felt welcomed. And this is such a loving and diverse community. And I was like, yeah, I wanted to be part of this. And Robert and Kate has been so phenomenal. Robert's just, he's love, right? And I want to be a part of that. So before we practice, we still got some people coming in. There is a poem I wanted to read from John Wellwood. Forget about enlightenment. Sit down wherever you are and listen to the wind singing in your veins. Feel the love, the longing, the fear in your bones. Open your heart to who you are right now, not who you would like to be, not the saint you're striving to become, but the being right here before you, inside you, around you. All of you is holy. You are already more and less than whatever you can know. Breathe out. Touch in, let go. So let's practice a little bit. I like to meditate with my eyes closed. You can practice with your eyes open if it feels comfortable. If you do keep your eyes open, pick a spot on the ground, maybe a couple of feet in front of you or a foot or two in front of you. Rest your gaze in that spot. Maybe soften your focus, lower your lids a bit. So either way, eyes open or eyes closed. And yeah, let's jump in. So just bring your attention into your body. Noticing your posture. Noticing points of contact that you're making with the ground, with the cushion or the chair that you're sitting on. Bringing the attention into this body, noticing this breath right now. Just letting everything else fall away in the background. Don't need to figure out the rest of the day right now. We don't need to figure out the grocery list. Don't need to think about all the things that we could have or should have done earlier. Just allowing yourself to arrive right now. Right here in this body that feels and thinks and breathes. turning your attention to the breath. Just allowing your breath to go its natural pace. Noticing the rise and fall of your chest or your belly, or the sensation of breath entering and exiting your nostrils. Noticing the aliveness of the breath. Breathing in, there's that kind of energetic, breathing in energy. And then when we exhale, there's that little moment of release, of letting go. We have this breath, just a perfect anchor for meditation. The thing to return to, of course, we get distracted by thoughts, by sounds, by sensations, all the phenomena that arises and passes. And that simple training is to return to the breath. Return gently, without criticism, without judgment. So breathing some gratitude into the breath right now, some appreciation for this perfect focus of meditation. With each breath, we know that we're alive. So offering a big thank you to this breath. Thank you. Sharon Salzberg calls it our friend, the breath. So thank you, friend. The thing that allows me to return my true home, this moment, this breath. Thank you. And so we're breathing in and out of our lungs and our nostrils and the air passageways. So breathing some gratitude into the lungs, into the nose. And sending some appreciation into the sense door of smell. Maybe we have some limited capacity of smell. Or maybe we have a full, vibrant range of smell available to us. And just reflecting on all the things that this nose has smelled through the years. All the foods, the spicy, the sweet. All the different smells of our homes. Smell that we get when we hug a loved one. Or if you've ever smelled a baby's scalp, freshness, that beautiful smell of a baby. So offering some thanks, some appreciation into the sense of smell that we have. Just think of all the different smells we have around our community. after it rains. All the vegetation, the plants and the trees. I know just walking around my neighborhood this summer with the windows open in people's houses and going by and the incense and the food they're cooking and flowers in their gardens. So offering a thank you to each of those smells and this nose and the nostrils and the sense of smell that we have. Breathing gratitude all through the nose and the sense door of smell. And of course, smell is directly related to taste. And so we have this mouth and this tongue full of taste buds. Sending a big thank you to the tongue. Thank you, tongue. Thank you, teeth that grind up the food and the lips. And the saliva and the system that digests the food. But oh, the wonderful things that we've eaten through our years. And sure, there's been some unsavory things, some downright nasty things I've tasted, that's for sure. But just reflecting on all the things that have brought you some appreciation. Food that's brought you nourishment. Maybe some of us have some food issues, but we all have to eat. So maybe just reflecting on the fact that with good, proper, balanced diet, the food we eat brings us fuel, energy. So offering thanks to the parts that you can appreciate. The sweet things and the salty things and the bitter and savory things. Maybe your grandma or a loved one used to make you something when you were a child that really brought you a lot of joy. Send in some big thank you. Thank you to the mouth, the tongue, the teeth, the taste buds, the stomach that digests it all. Thank you. And we have these ears on the sides of our heads that take in all the audible information. So sending a thank you to each of the ears and the eardrums and the sense door of hearing. Thank you. Just reflecting on all the wonderful things that we've heard through the years. Birds singing, laughter of children, the voice of somebody that we care about or that cares for us. Sounds of nature, of waves crashing on beaches and the wind going through the leaves and the forests. If you're a fan of music, reflect on all the wonderful kinds of music available to us. Think of some of the favorite pieces or bands or songs that you that just bring you joy, bring a smile to your face when you hear them, that lift your spirits, or maybe motivate you for exercise. So sending a big thank you to the ears and the eardrums and the sense of hearing at whatever capacity that we have. Just reflecting on all the information that we've taken in audibly through our ears. All the learning, the lessons. All the teachers we've had, and the talks and the speeches we've heard. Maybe we're a fan of spoken word or poetry or plays or movies, comedy. Just reflecting on all the wonderful, lovely, powerful, pleasant things that we've heard through the years, the things that we've heard this morning. Offering thanks to the ears, the sense of hearing. Thank you. Thank you to each ear. Thank you to the mouth and the sense of taste. Thank you to our breath. And sending some thanks into the eyes. Offering some appreciation to the sense door of sight. And again, whatever capacity, limited or not. Thank you to the eyes and all the parts of the eyes, the iris and the optic nerve and the pupil. Reflecting on all the things that we've seen through all our years. The sunsets and the sunrises. The deserts, the forests, the mountains. All the beauty that we've seen in nature. Beauty of the man-made objects, too. Incredible architecture around town. Great works of art. We're here in Portland, and all the different surprises around every corner, the big murals and intersections on the ground, and the art installations in people's yards. Patchwork art cars driving around. All the traditional art on walls and sculpture. Art in form of dance and plays. And even all the wonderful movies and TV shows that are available. Things that have brought us joy, there are things that have brought us emotion, have moved us. All the visual things that we've taken in. And art and nature. Just reflecting on the smiles that we've seen that have generated our own smile. Smile from a friend, a loved one, stranger. All taken in through the eyes and the sense of sight. So sending a thank you to each eye. Thank you. Thank you. Just reflecting on all the visual things that we've taken in through the sense of sight that's brought us happiness. It's brought us interest, awe. Maybe we've seen some things that have, with our eyes that has motivated us to take action, to stand up for ourselves or others. Maybe go protest. And of course, our sight has motivated us to get out of danger, something moving towards us. Something falling, something dangerous to avoid. So thank you to all the functions of the eyes and the sense of sight. Thank you. Breathing some of that gratitude in each of the eyes, the sense of sight. Bring some gratitude through the whole body and all the organs, the veins and the nerves, the muscles, the tendons, the joints, the bones. I'm sure we all have our problems with these bodies, but each of us has had the capacity to bring us here today. So offering a thanks to this body that breathes and feels, digests, this body that loves. So breathing some gratitude through all the organs and the veins and the nerves, every cell in the body. The skin with the sense of touch, the sense door touch. Sending a caring thank you to every cell in the body. And just reflecting on all the wonderful things that we've touched through the years. The fuzzy things and the warm things and the cool things and the smooth and the rough. Reflecting on what it feels like to hug a loved one, someone that cares for you or you care for. Or that time that somebody just lightly touched your shoulder or your arm that just let you know that they saw you, that they appreciated you. Thank you to the sense of touch. Sending that gratitude through the over the surface of the skin and everything underneath the skin, the whole body that and all the functions. Not to deny anything, any of this, the conditions or the illnesses or the injuries, some of the limitations that we have, but to hold it all and appreciate what we do have. Just offering a simple thank you over and over to the functions of the body and the things that this body has experienced. Thank you. Thank you. Sending our gratitude out past this body, this idea of this body, this idea of self. Sending gratitude out into this room, this space. What a wonderful space this is. An old church with its stained glass and its creaky boards and all its character and its charm and its openness and the love in here. Thank you. Sending some appreciation throughout this community here, this group of people, whether you know any of them or none of them. All of us showing up for our own reasons. But ultimately, all of us wanting the same things, we just want to be happy. We want to feel comfortable in our own skin. To be free from suffering. And the fact that we all want to awaken together. So sending some gratitude throughout this group of people, this community. If you have any friends in the space, offer a little extra loving thank you to each one of them. Just kind of touching them. Sprinkling a little fairy dust over them. Thank you to all the people that have made this day possible, all the people that have helped set up and clean and greet. And there's a whole bunch of great food in the back room waiting for us all when we're done. And all the people that have put care and love into making that food, bringing it here. What wonderful generosity. So offering a big thank you to all the volunteers, all the work that's gone into making today happen. Thank you. Filling this room with gratitude and appreciation, showering it over each one of us. Like the sun shining down on us, gratitude. Warming us all, filling us all, connecting us all. Sending that gratitude out into the community. Our friends and our loved ones, the people that have helped us out, people that have offered kind presence to us. Sending a thank you out into our benefactors, family members, loved ones. Thank you to the people that keep this community safe and protected. The people that care for the injured and the helpless and the homeless and the hungry. All the teachers, the ones in the schools and in the ones not in traditional places. Whether it's places of worship or meditation centers, totally secular. The guy in the garage that showed you how to change a spark plug. So sending that gratitude out to our benefactors, our teachers, our loved ones, family, our neighbors. Kindness that's been shown to us by strangers. A person that let you get in front of them in traffic. A person that replaced the paper towel roll that didn't have to. A person that held the door open for you. Thank you. Thank you to all the people that keep this community going. Public Works, all the people that help with communication, telephone, internet, the people that pave the roads, people that trim the trees out of the power lines and the telephone lines and trees that grow in the way of stop signs and stoplights. People that leave little bowls of water out for the dogs. So sending thanks out, gratitude out, appreciation out to everyone that keeps this community going. And of course there's problems and there's things that need to be corrected. But there's also a lot of good, a lot of worthwhile, wholesome actions taking place. Offering a thank you, if you can, to all the difficult and challenging people that you've experienced. Each one of us here have been a survivor. We've overcome everything that's come our way so far. And those difficult people, those challenging people, we have learned from them. Maybe they were just a model of what we didn't want to be or become. Or maybe they made us stronger. Our character, who we are, is the product of overcoming all these challenges. So if you can, muster a little thank you out to all those people that we've learned from. People that we've grown from. And maybe we need to set a strong boundary and never deal with them again, never be around them again, but maybe send a little thanks to the lessons we learned. And sending some thanks out, some appreciation out to all the ones that we've come across on our path. The path that we've traveled until now. When we were born and our caregivers, the doctors, whether it was parents or other caregivers that took care of us, or a caregiver. Somebody clothed us, somebody fed us. Somebody changed us. So offering thanks, a thank you to the ones that sheltered us and clothed us and fed us in those early years. Thank you. And the family and the friends that we had in early life, community, the ones that we laughed with and played with, learned from, the ones that allowed us to cry on their shoulder. Thank you. All the people that we've had relationships through the years. Platonic, romantic, the friends, the teachers, the ones that we've shared time with on our path, the people that we've grown with, grown up with, learned from. Thank you. different people and the characters that we've gone to school with and we've worked with and lived with. People that we've spent time with. Sure, there's been difficulties, but bring to mind some of the times of joy with these people. The times we've experienced some really profound or even difficult experiences with others. Sometimes that's created incredible bonds with people through the years. That we've survived this together, whatever this thing was. So offering thanks to those. Thank you. All our teachers, the ones that have inspired us, our spiritual teachers, whether it's been in this community or other communities. Some of the great ones through the years that maybe have inspired us. Gandhi, the Buddha, Muhammad, Martin Luther King Jr., Pee Wee Herman, whoever we've learned from. Let's help us grow. That's brought us joy. Sending a thank you to each one. Thank you. All the ones that have either walked with us shoulder to shoulder, hand in hand along our path, up until now, side by side, the ones that have had to push us, the ones that have had to pull us, the ones that have had to carry us at some times. Thank you. Thank you. Sending that gratitude out in all directions, all over the world, to all the different sites and the people and the actions and the art and the beauty. Sending a warm, loving thank you in all directions. The stars in the sky, the sun and the moon. Thank you. Bring it back down into this room, into this body. This breath. Thank you. Thank you. This moment right now. Thank you. Thank you for sharing your practice. So now we have the wonderful gym coming up. We're going to move. We're going to get some energy in these bones. Maybe. I have a lot of appreciation for gym. Such loving, warm energy.
Okay. Standing up and feeling our connection with the floor to begin with. Just imagine our connection with the earth. And for some reason, the last few days, I've been working with the four elements as I become aware of them in my body. So I've been using my movement as a reflection on the four elements. So I'll just sort of indicate some of where we can practice, you know, the directions we can practice with the four elements. So at the beginning, we're in touch with the earth, and if we look in the commentaries of the sutras, the earth is represented as a stable, solid element that supports us in all sorts of ways. So we can play with that a little bit by sinking into it and just rising up. So we press down into the earth and it presses back. And our form can be sinking and more solid, or it can be rising from a foundation. Sinking and rising. Playing with the element of the earth. Then if we connect this motion in the knees and the legs with our breath, we can lift our arms with the inhale and allow the air to press on the lungs and then release and coordinate the air with the earth. Expansion, we're moving against the earth. Contraction, we're kind of surrendering to it. It has an attraction, it pulls us in. So the earth and the air play together. And we say things like lift the arm or lift the hands. But the way that works is that a lot of things cooperate. The shoulder, the arms, the wrists, the palms, the fingers all work together. And they somehow know each other. They know what the other folks are doing. So when we say lift, there's a smoothness and a fluidity. It's like the water. There's a fluid aspect to the joints, the shoulders, the elbows, the wrists, the individual knuckles and the fingers and hands. So the water element is often discussed as an element of cohesion, which doesn't always seem clear at the beginning. The water element just arrived. But in the commentaries, they talk about, you know, what happens with the flower, which is easily blown away by the wind. When you mix it with water, develops a cohesion, it holds it together. We form loaves of bread or biscuits or dumplings or all lots of different ways, but there's a cohesion in our hands and arms. Not just the fluidity is connectedness. That's open to the side. Different joints expand and contract, but there's a cohesion to the form. It flows together. When the streams flow down the mountain, they flow together into patterns that we call streams. But it's water connecting electromagnetically. There's an electromagnetic attraction that keeps the water all organized and everything in it gets organized. Could be the bread or biscuits, could be our tendons and muscles and nerves. We open our arms and there's a cohesion to the whole fluid movement. And the more we do this, the more we feel the fire, the energy inside heating up the body because we're working muscles that create heat. We can lift overhead, paint a rainbow, and use the fire of the imagination to create the movement. The imagination is like an element in the body. It guides the gesture. So ideas have an element of fire. There's an element of fire in the nervous system that collects concepts like the clouds, separating clouds. There's an idea, and that idea organizes our movement and motivates us to stretch and then release. Someone saying the word separate the clouds communicates, the fire of communication. Communication within the body, from one part to the next, and communication within the room between people. Let's open now. Palms up, we're resisting gravity. And then we're pressing forward, using the breath to push. Breathe in, build up pressure, and then ruin the expansion. Not ruin it, but diminish the expansion. So we're lifting, or not lifting, but expanding. And then I can't feel it and then talk about it too. It's much easier when I'm quiet. So the air is expansion and contraction. The earth is solidity, stability, foundation, firmness. The water is cohesion and fluidity. The fire is lightness. I think that idea came from watching a literal fire. Did you ever see a flame go down? It always goes up. It's a lightness. It's transmuting something into light and lifting at the same time. So it's light as something we see and lightness as something we feel rising. So we're going to pull back and come back and around. So there's a lightness to our arms when we have power lifting and then power receding and letting the lightness fade. It gets heavy. We're up in the clouds, we're down into the earth. We rise like vapor, we condense like dew. So all these natural images link together the four elements. And the body is participating in those four elementary energies, lifting, receding. The lightness of the arm as it floats up is reversed by the heaviness as it descends to the earth. The fluidity in the shoulder as we reach across, the water creates cohesion between the shoulder and the fingertips. It's actually a cohesion all the way back down into the feet. Everything cooperates to get a gesture going. And then turning the waist, we gaze at the moon. Surrender to gravity in the center, and then lift up again. The idea of turning and gazing at the moon creates a gesture, and the body follows that gesture, and then it changes it. So one of the suggestions for working with the elements is to say, when are they still? When are they solid and unchanging? There's a solidity to the earth, but we know that there's always the possibility of an earthquake. There's a solidity to the mountain, but then the breezes dry out the soil and blow it around, and it ends up as erosion down in the valley. There's a reflection on impermanence with every gesture that involves the elements. They never stay the same. Cohesion is relative cohesion. It's not forever. Pushing, there's a fluidity that drops away. And then another gesture is fluid, and then it drops away. So through the four elements, we can reflect on impermanence. An element is not a thing. It's a dynamic process. It's constantly changing, constantly unfolding, re-emerging. Let's reach across, again, using the fire of the imagination. This upper hand is a cloud, a lower hand is a shadow, and we turn the body in a certain way, and we get this story that the hand is telling about the cloud going across the sky with a shadow. That's the fire of the imagination. It's the lightness. Just a little suggestion from the person in the front of the room, then suddenly everybody's imagination has got something to play with. And it creates a stability, concentration, but it fades. Suddenly we think about where we have to be on Tuesday. So concentration comes and goes, but when it's there, it's solid like the earth. Or it could be light like the fire. All these things we call elements are combining and recombining in a million different ways. All right, let's release. That's the first half of Shibashi, which you're all familiar with. Here's another one that's not so familiar, but it's this is where I started working with the elements the other day. I was, standing, both feet in touch with the floor, lifting my arms, feeling the breath fill my lungs, the pressure in the breath, and then stepping and pressing forward, I release the breath. So I was expanding the lungs and letting them collapse. I was creating two circles with my hands, fluid, circular movements, riding back, pushing forward. When I pushed forward, my forward foot pressed into the earth. When I moved back, my shoulders the shoulder blades came together. So there was a contraction in the back as my elbows were back. Then the shoulder blades had to part and expand in order for me to reach. And when I came back, I was balanced on the back leg. Let's just stay there for a second. We're balanced on the back leg. The toe is rising like the flame. It's light. It doesn't have any solidity or heaviness or connection to the earth. And then we press, and that foot takes all the pressure. We glide back, and the earth element shifts to the other leg. So walking down the street is a dance with earth. We put our weight on one foot as we stride, Come back to the center. We can feel the weight on both feet. We can step out to the other side. Feel the earth in the lead foot. Feel the earth in the back foot. Feel the fluidity of the arms. So after we've played with these four elements, expanding the lungs, moving the nervous system by intending to create circles, moving the body mechanics so it's actually a circle, floating across the room as we, if we were walking, we'd just be alternating the weight in an easy rhythm, walking down the street, walking across the room. Then we come back to the center. And then a short reflection. Is the body earth? Does the body contain earth? Does earth have the body? Does it own the body? Whose earth is it? Is it the body's earth? Does the earth have the body? Does the body have water? Is it a thing that can be contained? Or was it a dynamic process that we can recall now? Our arms were moving in a circle or in a compression or retraction. Whose body is it? Does it belong to me? Who's me? Me is somehow this awareness of four elemental dynamic processes unfolding moment to moment. Does me have this body? Does it own this body? When we put this body into motion, is it a little Dharma reflection on process, impermanence, anatta? Hopefully it's not suffering. But having the awareness of a lack of suffering because of the fluidity and the balance and the strength of the body, here's a point where dukkha evaporates for a while. Pleasure is a cohesion in the body. It's like mixing the water and the flour. There's a pleasure that blends with all the cells when we get into a flow of walking or qigong. But whose is it? It's just important to ask the questions and then hold still and be silent. So again, we sink, lift the arms away from the earth, let them float up like a flame, sink, exhale, let the lungs contract, feel the fluidity coming up and over in a round form and then a descent into the earth, and one more. Hopefully your imagination's all lit up right now. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. I see some new faces. Are there people here who are here for the first time? Welcome. I hope you love it. We love you. Thank you, Gary. I can't believe so many of you came out on this beautiful morning. Isn't it wonderful? Walking the dog, the weather, the temperature was perfect. The news of the day. Oh, my name's Kate. The children's program will resume. Monica will be back on September 11th. I think it's the second week of September. And we'll be glad to have our little kids back. There's a lot that's going to be happening in the next couple months. We're going to have a volunteer fair on the 18th, I think is the date, September 18th. So if you are interested in finding time in your life to participate more fully in the life of PIMC and express your gratitude to this community, we'll be there to support you and give you information, and we'll have lists out. Kempo Sawang will be here for 3 days, September 16th in the evening, 17th all day, and the 18th in the evening. All of this information will be available on the website. However, we also have an announcement list, just an email list for formal announcements, and we have a listserv for those for a little more casual discussion. It's called the forum, and that's community members can talk to one another, which is kind of fun. Barney, do you want to talk about what you're going to do? You want me to just mention it? Okay. Barney's going to be talking to us about the Tao. And if it's something that draws you, I strongly suggest that you attend. And that will be in the evening on September 22nd. And it should be really, really interesting and wonderful. I think it's a Friday night. Whatever day that is, check on the website. Robert will be doing a retreat at Brighton Bush late in October again. And if you've never been to Brighton Bush, it's really wonderful there. And that's a lovely retreat. So treat yourself. He'll be there again at the end of the year. So he has a number of Brighton Bush events this year. Jim, our beloved Jim, will be doing the Dharma consultations today. Have the libraries open? Yeah. If you don't know,
Indulge Your Mind.
Han takes care of a beautiful library for us, and it's right back in our living room. And I know sometimes this door seems like it's a doorway into another world, and it's really not. It's the less formal part of this community, but the library is wonderful and rich, and we thank you, Han. Thank you to Greg on the camera today. There are so many people who make this Sunday happen, all the way from greeters to the people who provide treats and make coffee and stuff back in the living room. We do have, we always have what we call hospitality through this door, and it's just a place to relax and get to know people. Some of you know I like to tell a story that it took me a full year to make it through that door. I know how many people suffer from just being uncomfortable in a group of people they don't know. Walk through the door. It's a great group, and we try really, really hard to acknowledge one another and to let you feel welcome and comfortable. A year is too long to wait. We do have the potential for some spot on volunteering today. The garden needs to be weeded. So if your heart calls to you to get out in the sunshine for a little while, we will have that opportunity. And I hope you get, where's Rod? Did I see Rod? He got away. Talk to Paul and Paul can point you. Thanks. We have, for those of you who don't know, we operate on Donna. Right now we're operating at a deficit. And so we have a number of ways for you to express your gratitude to the teachings and to help us keep this place alive. We've been here for over 10 years now, but expenses have gone up, and it's really, really important that you examine your heart and think about what this community means to you. We have what we call the Stewardship Circle, which is a regular online monthly giving program, and you'll be hearing more about that. We're going to have a community meeting next month as in October as well. But in the meantime, if you're not ready to take that step, that's fine. We do have the Donna box at the back of the room. It's a way of expressing your gratitude. This Dharma seed, this center, this place is an extraordinary, when you're here, it doesn't seem like it. We can take it for granted. But it is an extraordinary community and place, an opportunity to study the Dharma among friends and without judgment in a place that's full of love. So if you've got a little extra love in your heart and a little extra money in your pocket, that would be delightful. It's the wooden box right back there. Did I miss anything? Yes.
It doesn't have to be extra money. It could just be something that you choose to
contribute. That's true. That's true. Thank you, Had. That's well said. Right language. Very nicely said. Okay, thank you for listening, my friends.
All right. So everybody's got three tags and a pen? All right. Anybody else? Raise your hand if you don't. Cool. All colors, of course, are accepted. If your tag is of a different color, please embrace it and welcome it. Why did I say that? So, I found it interesting. Last time I was here, I talked about forgiveness, which is kind of an offshoot of metta. This time I'm talking about gratitude, an offshoot of metta, maybe mudita as well. This poem includes probably my favorite line about gratitude from Melody Beattie. She calls it Words of Gratitude. Say thank you until you mean it. Thank God, life, and the universe for everyone and everything sent your way. Gratitude unlocks the fullness of life. It turns what we have into enough and more. It turns denial into acceptance, chaos to order, confusion to clarity. It can turn a meal into a feast, a house into a home, a stranger into a friend. It turns problems into gifts, failures into successes, the unexpected into perfect timing, and mistakes into important events. It can turn an existence into real life and disconnected situations into important, beneficial lessons. Gratitude makes sense of our past, brings peace to today, and creates a vision for tomorrow. Gratitude makes things right. Gratitude turns negative energy into positive energy. There's no situation or circumstance so small or large that is not susceptible to gratitude's power. We can start with who we are and what we have today, apply gratitude, and then let it work its magic. My favorite part is gratitude turns what we have into enough and more. Boom, right? I You know, I am super uncomfortable when I hear people talking about meditation and spiritual practices that bring abundance. It makes me cringe. But, you know, the flip side of that is the, you know, the idea of scarcity, that we don't have enough, you know, and if we turn on the TV and listen to the radio and look at all the ads on the internet, we're not pretty enough, we're not smart enough, we're not fit enough, we're not tan enough, we're not, our house isn't big enough, our car isn't new enough, we don't have the new phone that vibrates you in just the right way. That was weird. I've never said that in my life before. That's that will not be included in future talks. You know what I mean, right? Our culture is set up to tell us we're not enough, that we don't have enough, that we're not going to be happy until we get this thing, that we possess this thing. You know, I had coffee with a friend yesterday. Is Ron here? I see Ron. No. I had coffee with him yesterday, and we were talking about a well-known Zen teacher who kind of got in some trouble a while back, and his program was like, pay me $3,000 and I'll have you meditating like a monk in a week. And, you know, that just goes to the whole, you know, you're not good enough. You know, pay this money and you'll be happy. You know, pay this money, possess this thing, and everything will be all right. And, of course, we know that's a losing battle. Always the new operating system, the new iPhone, the new car, the bigger house. So that's where, you know, I found this intentional practice of gratitude, turning what we have into enough. You know, it's not, I come from a background of repression. My household, the way to survive was to just stuff it down. And I don't know if I talked about this last time. If you met my mom, you'd say, she is a saint. She's so happy all the time. She's Pollyanna. How you doing, Pat? Oh, everything's wonderful. Fake. Very, everything negative, stuffed down, total denial of the difficult, the challenging, the pain. And that's where this practice of gratitude isn't to deny anything. It's just to hold it all and kind of shift our perception a little bit. Like, yeah, it's a little warm in here today. My antiperspirant gave out a long time ago. And this is a lovely morning. And I feel great. That's a little thing. Philip Moffitt, I should give credit. Philip Moffitt from Spirit Rock, he's a wonderful teacher. And if you're new to Buddhism and interested in Buddhism, his book, Dancing with Life, I think is one of the best books out there that I just amazing. But he talks about having an and practice with gratitude. So, you know, to fully acknowledge, like, I am losing my hair. And I got a great fucking haircut the other day. You know, I got to sit with some friends yesterday, and I haven't seen my friend Jake for a while, and he as soon as he walked in, he's like, that's a great haircut, where'd you get it? And the feeling I got was warmth, was happiness, you know, joy. I felt seen. I felt acknowledged. You know, and that's from gratitude. I know a lot of us, I think it's a common thing, a lot of us don't take compliments well. And, you know, that kind of shows us where we need to work, you know, on this, you know, being okay with, you know, this person, being able to receive that, to be able to love ourselves. And yeah, and receive gratitude, because it's all around. That's the thing. You know, we have difficult lives. We have challenges. Recently I got a bill from the IRS. I owe $10,000 to the IRS. And I got a roof over my head. And I have the ability to make payments on it. And. You know, it's so easy to get wrapped up in the difficult stuff. So easy to get, you know, how many, it's the I have the idea, you know, you're tying your shoelace in the morning, the shoelace breaks, oh, my day is ruined. You know, we hang on to that stuff. That becomes our reality, the stuff that we hang on to. And it's just a slight shift of perception to shift our attention to the thing that's good in our lives, the thing that's wholesome, that's of value, that brings us joy, that brings us peace, freedom. You know, I keep looking over here. This pile keeps growing. This is going to be given to the homeless. There's blankets and shoes. And what a wonderful offering of generosity. Like, you know, that somebody could easily come in and like, look at all that junk. Or, you know, that's going to do a lot of good. That's going to bring some people some comfort. And the effort that took, the fact that somebody went through their stuff and like, yeah, I'm not going to throw this away. I'm going to bring this to PIMC. I'm going to bring this with an intention of offering it to somebody else. I mean, that's just a wonderful offering of generosity. And it's something to be grateful for. Anybody that's offered to that's something to be proud of. It's something to really hold of value. Like, yeah, I did something good. I did something of value. One of my favorite lines from Meister Eckhart, if the only prayer you said in your whole life was thank you, that would be enough. I think I used the term thank you a few times during my meditation. Albert Einstein says there's only two ways to live your life. One is though nothing is a miracle. The other is though everything is a miracle. It's about perception, right? So, you know, as I mentioned earlier, when I did forgiveness and it was an offshoot of metta, this idea of gratitude being an offshoot of metta. So, you know, in metta, we offer ourselves and we offer others the phrase, you know, may you be happy, may you be well. We start to let go of some of the resentments. We start to let go of some of the difficulty, the challenges, and really start to look at the things of value in these people or ourselves. And gratitude arises. And, you know, and then we can go and take this out. So we build gratitude in our hearts and in the way that we deal with these people, that, like, you know, we really start to appreciate them. Yeah, they did, you know. I got very specific in my last talk. I didn't catch any flack from it, but I don't want to name too many names today. But, you know, there are people in my life that have done some things that I'm you know, that have been challenging, you know, that have rubbed me the wrong way, or I should say I've allowed myself to get rubbed the wrong way. I allowed my buttons to get pushed, right? We were talking about this the other day. So there's these things that I could focus on, and, you know, and that could be my story, this person. You know, they walk in the room, and, oh, yeah, there's so-and-so. You know, or, you know, that shift of, that just that little shift. Oh, here's so-and-so that, you know, offers stuff to the homeless. Or here's so-and-so that the other day smiled at me. You know, here's, I keep saying so-and-so, that's a, isn't that an old, oh, that so-and-so? It's a little negative connotation to it. I'll just, my wife, how about with that? We'll talk about, I told her I was going to talk about her today. We have been married, it was 16 years last year, or this year. That's a long time. That's a long time to, you know, there of course there's been difficulties. She is a saint for putting up with me through the years. And, you know, and certainly easy to pin, like, oh yeah, you did this, and you did that, and you should have done this, and you should have done that. That list, right? That scorecard that we keep. And, you know, with the practice of gratitude, shifting the attention of the things that my wife has, just the fact that she's allowed me to stay in the house for this long. The fact that she's put up with all, you know, the full range of me. And the fact that we have two incredible daughters that is totally her fault. I have two incredibly compassionate and smart and artistic daughters. That alone is just something to be so grateful for. But the fact that my wife has devoted herself to raising these daughters, we've been lucky enough to be in a position. She hasn't had to work the whole time up until now that I have a daughter in middle school and daughter in high school. That's something that I'm incredibly grateful for. But and then there's this woman that shares the bed with me, this woman that walks beside me. My better half, who has made tons of mistakes, as I have, and she just is, she's independent, she's strong, she's incredibly intelligent, she's crafty, incredible mother. That's the stuff I want to remember. That's the stuff I want to think about. That's the stuff that gets me up in the morning. That's the stuff that allows me to sleep better at night. Not the difficult stuff. So there's a way to hold this all. There's I was talking about that idea of scarcity, and I know for me, I had this idea that there's like this cosmic scorecard. When somebody else, this is where it kind of falls into the mudita part. You know, the mudita is when we offer ourselves and others, we appreciate the happiness, the joy that they have. We encourage that this continues to grow and build in their lives. Kind of mixed with may you learn to appreciate the success and the joy that you experience in your life without clinging to it. Right, so this idea, like Jim's talking about, impermanence. You know so let's be grateful for what we have right now, because it's going to go away or it's going to change eventually. Right. So with the mudita, I used to have this idea that if you earned something, you got that promotion, you got the better car, you got the better looking girlfriend, whatever it is, that like I had this core thing like that meant I wasn't going to get it. That, you know, that the fact that somebody else got this stuff, that there's less of a chance, or it's just not even a possibility for me anymore. You know, and so with the practice of mudita, you know, in recognizing the joys, and, you know, without comparison, without judgment, without criticism, without envy, you know, gratitude arises out of that. Like, oh yeah, you got the new promotion, good for you. I still have all the possibilities in the world. I have to do the work. It's not going to fall in my lap, but there's still a full spectrum of possibility available to me. You can get everything in the world for you. I have friends that have had incredible successes, incredible accomplishments, and I'm happy for them. I don't have to sit there and stew on it. I've done enough of that. We're talking. I've done enough of the old way. The new way is being able to hold this and really allowing myself to fill with gratitude for your stuff, your happiness. And as far as like in this realm, all my friends that go on long retreats, I'm just not able to. The work I have, I can't take off more than 7 to 10 days a year for a retreat. And I have some friends that get to go on, you know, 3-month, 6-month retreats. I actually have a friend that just left for a 3-year retreat. And, you know, and early on, I kind of like, oh, yeah, I can't do that myself. And, you know, with practice, you know, that Like somebody said, you know, he says, I'm going on a 3-year retreat. Oh, man. Awesome. That's incredible. This world is going to be a better place because of his practice, that level of dedication. It's wonderful. So, you know, there's studies now. As there's studies with, what's the one with mindfulness in general. 6 weeks of 10 minutes a day, there are measurable changes in the brain. You know, there's all kinds of studies. That's the one I like to talk. I mean, that's you know, it's not that long. It's dedication, doing it every day. So now with gratitude, there's a lot of studies. Dr. Edmonds of, I think UCLA, and Davis and McCullough of University of Miami, they did a study where they had one group for a week wrote down the things they're grateful for. They had a second group write down their daily irritations or the things that displeased them, and a third wrote events that had affected them with no emphasis on being positive or negative. And after 10 weeks of doing that, the people who wrote gratitude were more optimistic and felt better about their lives. They also, surprisingly, they exercised more and had fewer visits to physicians than those who focused on sources of aggravation. And there's another, in the University of Pennsylvania did a study. They had a control group of writing about early memories. When it got to a week's assignment of writing and personally delivering a letter of gratitude to someone who has never been properly thanked for his or her kindness, the participants immediately exhibited a huge increase in happiness scores. This impact was greater than any of the other interventions of the studies, and the benefits of it lasted over a month. So science, right? Now there's proof of it. And so I've, you know, I mentioned last time I'm sober. You know, I got sober in 12-step groups. And a big part of 12-step, they talk about making gratitude lists. And, you know, because us alcoholics and addicts show up and we're full of anger and resentment and shame and guilt. And that's a good kind of intervention for that. You know, our sponsor will tell you, write a gratitude list right now. And so the first time I was told to do a gratitude list, I made I'm gonna do 20 things. I was ambitious. So I started with you know, I got a roof over my head. I got food in the cupboards. I got a family. You know, XYZ. When it got to the bottom of the list, it started getting a little, I think I put spaghetti and meatballs. It took me a while to finish that 20. But through the years, I've continued that practice. So I meditate like we've done. And there's so many different ways of doing a gratitude meditation. I think I kind of mix a couple different ways. Gratitude for the body and the functions. Gratitude. One of my teachers, George Haas, he does a thing where he takes his life in decades, starting with birth. You know, birth first 10 years. You know, 10 years to 20, and offering thanks to, you know, all the people and all the experiences, whatever, in each of those segments. Gratitude out and, you know, sitting out in outside, and I keep saying wilderness. It's not just wilderness. Sitting out anywhere outdoors and all the things that come to your senses, you know, the smells, the sounds and all that, and just offering thanks. It's a wonderful practice, but there is a great power in writing. So we're going to get to this in a little bit. That's what these tags are about here. But that 20-item list of gratitude took me a while to get to the end of it. I've continued that practice. I've, for the last 5 years, I've had a gratitude journal. It's a small diary. It's 365 pages, and there's 5 entries. So on each page, there's, you know, starting, what are we in, 2016? So starting in 11, is that right? I'm so bad with time. So, you know, like today I'll open up, and so in 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, I have entries of all what happened this day. So for the past 5 years, every night before I go to bed, I write one or two sentences of things that I'm grateful for that day. And that has changed everything. It has been completely transformative. You know, going back and looking at all the different things that, you know, that I've done, you know, with my work and with teaching and the different groups that I've been a part of and with my family and things that my daughters and my wife have done, places that I've gone. You know, and some days it's like, traffic wasn't that bad today. But there's a lot of really good stuff in there. I was going to bring the journal, and I was going to read the journal, my entries from today, and there was one on there that I was like, I don't want to read that one. But, you know, that's the thing. Our lives aren't perfect. There's a lot of difficulties, there's a lot of challenges, and we always have something to be grateful for. Always. You know, if it's just the core stuff, shelter, food, warmth, running water, you know, and I would say, you know, if you're moved to talk about the material stuff, go ahead. I find a greater value of reflecting on things that don't cost money. Experiences, those times of shared, you know, laughter and warmth and love and compassion. I've recently been hearing about, in that one study, a lot of people have been talking about writing gratitude letters. You know, writing a letter, offering it to somebody that has done something that was worthwhile, something that meant something to you. And there's a real power in that. That fact of, you know, putting it in the mail or handing it over. And then the gift of receiving that. Like last night, my friend Jake just mentioned, you know, about my haircut. But, you know, getting something in writing, that is just an incredible gift. You know, both for the writer and the recipient. Beyond that, we talked about journaling, compliments, offering others compliments, offering gratitude verbally. I've been making a practice about this for a while. Obviously, I'm a loud person. I don't get out in public and shrink. I'm kind of a spectacle sometimes, and I've learned to shift that instead of like, see me, you know, that was the thing, you know, that was the core thing, you know, I gotta be seen, I gotta be heard, I gotta, you know, put myself out there. Now, instead of, you know, just kind of shifting it, I go to a store, and, you know, and somebody's behind the counter, and they're helping me, and I just say, you know, boy, those glasses look great on you. You just caught my vision there, but, that's a great color on you. And seeing someone's face light up, and that, you know, the smile and the warmth, I mean, that just makes people's day. And, you know, and I'm not doing that to make myself some bodhisattva. You know, my intention is like, I got to get this energy out somewhere. And so I'm going to do it in a worthwhile way. I'm going to do it in a wholesome way. You know, and man, it changes everything. Transforms. It's beautiful. So, yeah. We have three tags. Like I said, they're not toe tags. These are, technically, these are shipping labels. Everybody has three of them. Everybody has a pen. And I wanted everyone to, we'll take a little time of writing down at least three things. Again, this is totally optional. I don't want anybody to stress over this or suffer over it. But if you're moved to, write down three things that you're grateful for, and we'll kind of sit a little bit. If you're moved to, there's another side. You can do six things. So let's take a little time here, and maybe some things that came to mind when we were meditating, or things that came to mind now as we're talking.
Yeah, one bite.
Our tags in the back the table if you want to grab any. This one's for Chip. Tibetan Buddhists, by the way. Beastie Boys. Done writing, just kind of sit and allow yourself to kind of soak this in a little bit. Some things that you wrote, written about. I wanted to see the Beastie Boys, and their shows always sold out. I lived in Florida in the 90s when they were popular, and the shows sold out right away, and I could never get in, and I was so bummed out. I don't know how many years ago it was. It was within the last 5 years or so. My sister got tickets in Long Beach, California, and it was one of them. And I've gone to a lot of concerts. I have at least 4 album or scrapbook ticket albums full of tickets that I've gone to since the 80s, and it was incredible. They did a rap set, and then they came out, and the stage spun around. And they did an instrumental set, and they were wearing powder blue tuxedo, like 70s tuxedos. And then the stage turned around again, and they came out with full band instruments, just these guys. And they did a punk rock set, and then they disappeared for a while, and then they showed up in the stands doing a rap set again. And it was just, they included the audience and just the incredible energy, and that's not going to happen again. You know, we've lost one of the members. You know, I lit a candle earlier, and I light. One quite a bit for my friend Philip. That he was part of my sangha, and is just one of the most caring and kind and just lovely people in the world. And he couldn't take his suffering anymore. He's not with us anymore. And, you know, and I light a candle in remembrance of him and my old roommate Aaron, who just, I lived with Aaron for a while, and my sister brought him home, actually. I don't know if she's, hey, Julie. my sister, I think, hooked up with him. She was renting a room from me. She left for work, and I woke up in the morning, and you know, I was getting some breakfast, and I looked through the hallway, and I saw this dirty guy. Like, you know, my sister's room is kind of lovely and white and pretty, and there's this, like, hairy, there's this dirty thing, and, like, I got all freaked out, and I took out a knife, and I called up my sister, and, like, did you let somebody in the house? And she, oh, yeah, that's Aaron. She was the worst roommate in the world. Aaron ended up renting the room from me after her, and he was the best roommate ever. And I recently had to bury him. He died from an overdose. But you know, I light that candle, and I think about these people. They're not around anymore, but you know, I think about the good things, the things that have warmed my heart. You know, the smiles and the laughter and. You know, and I spent a lot of time with Aaron, and I mean, we consoled each other, and he'd torment me with Janis Joplin cranked out of his room, and he was a lovely, warm human being, and heroin got him. So, we have a handful of gratitude here, right? So I wanted to pass around a mic if anybody's... Is this thing supposed to light up? Oh, there we go. There we go. So if anybody's moved to share about any or all of their things, I just wanted us to kind of share as a group. And so the practice is as people offer their things, you know, really take this into your heart. You know, meditate on this. Soak it in. Let it fill yourself up with this stuff that's available to all of us. Is anybody willing to kick it off? I will start with, I'm grateful for great music and art. I'm grateful for a home full of beautiful and compassionate women. I'm grateful for big smiles and laughter. I'm grateful for my loving heart. Chris, let me just pass it around from there.
Hi. I'm grateful for recently moving to Portland and all the time I get to spend with my wife and son now. Everything my own dharma and meditation practice has allowed, which is a lot. And of course, coffee. And pizza and humor.
I'm grateful for my sister, who's an addict and suffers with mental illness, and when she does the full range of her, it's just incredible. Mm-hmm. I'm also really grateful to all the gurus and students who pass these teachings of awakening down across the centuries so that I can benefit, each of us can benefit.
Mm. So. Thanks.
I have more, but I'm only gonna do two.
I didn't write it in my cards, but I'm grateful that I can read these, even though I forgot to bring my glasses this morning. I wrote large. I'm grateful for my health and my physical stamina. I'm grateful for all of the opportunities that I've had and all of the amazing people that I've known. I'm grateful for a Lewis Tice seminar that I took in my early 20s, for Dr. Robin Murphy, for Girl Scouting, and for all of the other very positive things that have happened in my life and given me a positive attitude. And I'm grateful for PIMC.
I just pictured you in a Girl Scout outfit.
Many years.
I need to talk to you about that. I'm grateful for my husband's support of my spiritual seeking, attending retreats, and most recently being blown away by Frank Ostaseski and Roshi Joan Halifax. I'm grateful for my mother's loving attention and teaching of my children. And I'm grateful for my freedom of speech.
I'm grateful for moving to Portland and living close to my daughter and seeing her often. I'm grateful for my willingness to try new things and grow. I'm grateful for my good health as I age so that I can continue to explore. I'm grateful for my little house and its warmth and comfort. And I'm grateful for 12-step programs and their spiritual teachings.
Thanks. So I got a bunch of them, and I'll explain a few of them. I'm first grateful for great teachers, inspiring meditators, the internet, and how that has brought a lot of their teachings to me, growth, progression, and evolution, and mostly in relation to development and stuff. Kind-hearted people and people in general, good friends and brothers on the path, housing, nature, and the sun and the moon, good health, youth, and the freedom that I enjoy now, and community, and grocery stores, because, right, yeah.
Thanks.
I'm grateful for the gratitude journal, just as you had mentioned earlier. I'm most grateful for my daughters, Taylor and Madison, my greatest teachers, and our dog Jasmine too. I'm grateful for a recent insight that came to me. There is nothing more important than awareness. And I see that as the source for all experiences and the ability to participate in this world. Also grateful for a workshop that I took called Writing from the Heart, and other educational tools I've been fortunate to experience and benefit from. And there are lots more in my gratitude journal, and that's why that practice is so important.
Thanks.
I just recently arrived in Portland after a long-awaited journey across the country from North Carolina. And so I'm very grateful for my travel experience and that I'm finally out here, able to soak in some of this great place. I haven't been here long, but I'm gonna be here for a little while, so thankful for that. And I'm thankful for the love and support of family and friends in my journey. And also, in reference to something that you said earlier about our cultural thing about not being enough, this is the first thing I wrote. I'm grateful just for just being who I am and my capacity for love and learning and growth and creativity and talent and all that good stuff. So thank you.
Thank you. Behind you.
I have a lot to be grateful for. This body that breaks heals itself, and suffering from pain is something Robert told me is a choice, and that we can heal ourselves and get through that. Grateful to be in a society, a culture that allows me to express myself, that I don't have to feel weird about telling friends that I love them or that I can feel good opening up. And one thing I just really noticed the other day is that fresh water from a stream is always cold and refreshing. And that's just the day before yesterday, that was so great. Those are three.
Thanks, too. Okay.
Thank you. The first one that I wrote down was that I am still alive. And on a lot of different levels, part of that came from the practice you mentioned about and. You know, it seems like whenever I was diagnosed with COPD a few years back, and every time I sit and start focusing on the breath, I notice that I have difficulty breathing. And I'm still alive. and so I'm also grateful for refuge recovery, because that is also one of the things that has kept me alive from my addictions that wanted to kill me and still want to kill me. The other thing, you know, playing the Beastie Boys really got me. I don't really know the Beastie Boys at all, but I certainly know music and used to play guitar with Jerry Garcia and Bob Weir in the 60s down in the Bay Area. And just all my whole journey with music, art school, and poetry, and then it reminded me of a time that I had coffee with William Stafford, who is a gorgeous, absolutely beautiful Oregon poet, and him reminding me that if you want that Gary Snyder once said, if you want to be a poet, you need to have a craft, you need to work at something else for money. So anyway, but he comes to mind every once in a while. I'm incredibly grateful for the legacy that he's left.
Thanks, Michael.
When I first started writing these down, I wrote three things down, and the inertia was in play, and so I ended up going back for three more. And what I realized is that five of the six things were things that I couldn't possibly have been grateful for before my practice. The first one is the easy one, PIMC, without a doubt, right? And then the other things that ended up on my cards were my job, my ex-wife, my mother, my son, and my fellow Americans. Weird little mix there, but I just wanted to speak to, yeah, well, it's, you know, stream of consciousness, whatever comes popping out, right? You know, when you're talking about the idea of yes and, that really is very poignant, because I find it odd that, well, not odd, but I think it's wonderful that five of these six things were things that I couldn't possibly have been grateful for. And before my practice, in the realm of like popular spirituality, everybody wants, you know, gratitude's a big thing nowadays. And I gave it a shot, and it didn't work, because it was a but, it was not an and. And so there were always these contingencies of a painful relationship or a painful set of circumstances. It's like, well, yeah, I can be grateful for my health, but, you know, blah, blah, blah. There was always something that seemed to override that as a set of circumstances. And so whether that's true or not is not no longer relevant. It's like just the ability to feel gratitude and to look at these things as lessons and relationships that have grown and changed and learned, and to not, you know, not glue on to the negative, but to really fully sit and appreciate the positive and to accept both, I think is amazing. So I just want to add one more seventh thing. I'm grateful for gratitude. I'm grateful that it's finally kicking in.
Right on. Thanks.
My name's Chris. This is my first time in this room. And I've been practicing making a gratitude list every day on my phone with a little app that is built for that. And but yesterday my phone broke and I lost it. I'm thankful that I had these tags to write that my list on today. And I'm grateful for my relationship with my two daughters. And I'm grateful for this new community to practice with. And I'm grateful for this beautiful city. And I'm grateful also for my body's ability to heal itself. I'm grateful for my teachers. And I'm grateful for all my friends who care for me.
Thanks, Chris. Ooh, you know what? Oh, please, Kate. We need to wrap it up. I didn't realize where the time went.
It's because we're having a good time. While I was out of town last month, I discovered that one of my chickens is a rooster. I can't abide roosters. So I'm incredibly grateful for my friend Tanya, who has taken my rooster, and he doesn't have to be soup. I got a little chainsaw, a little electric chainsaw. Sometimes I bemoan my health and my age. I'm grateful that I was able to use my chainsaw, little 14, it's so cute. And I did a little pile of wood yesterday. Most would laugh, I didn't. I've had recently an experience of this lovely breeze that's been happening a lot, and my breath, and I'm grateful for the connection that's been made in my body and my practice. It feels like a way to actually become the earth. When the wind connects with your breath, it's like the earth breathing, and it's just such a lovely, yummy thing that I'm grateful for the silence that lets us find those things.
Thanks, Kate. So you can take these tags home with you, hang them on your rearview mirror, hang them on in the bathroom, so you see it when you're brushing your teeth, maybe not near the toilet. just as a visual reminder of something that's of value, something that you can shift your attention to, something that's real. Or you can give them to me. I am creating a gratitude tree at my house on Clatsop in Southeast 15th and Southeast Clatsop in Selwood. I got inspired. I saw a love wish tree off of Williams. And so I'm going to be building a gratitude tree. I'm going to put ribbons up and everybody's going to hang their little tags. And we get a lot of traffic. I'm right by Selwood Middle School too, so we get a lot of traffic there. So if you want to keep it, please do so. If you want to hand it over, just don't throw it in the trash. I mean, unless it's you want to keep it private as well. I honor that. So let's circle up and we end the group by holding hands. I mean, do we normally?
Yeah,
without the
we
kids?
Did before.
Okay, all right, cool. So, to begin with, just notice that we're all connected together. Yeah, that was intentional. I just love Earth, Wind, and Fire. So, we're connected, we've practiced together, we're growing together. This is real. This is of value. like Robert's little thing. Squeeze the hand of the person on your left. Send a little gratitude their way. A little squeeze over to the person to the right. Send some gratitude their way, whether you know them or not. And our little chant of Metta. May all beings be happy. May all beings be happy. May all beings be happy. Sadhu. 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 Put our hands together in respect for the practice and for the space and for the community. Thank you for sharing your practice. So we got food and community and love and hugs in through this hallway here. Yeah.